And good day, sir!
Welcome, everybody. After what was a little bit of a short wait, we are now here for your matchup of MTW versus J4T for the Defense Tournament, sponsored by Own3D TV, supported by Razer, and broadcast by every caster under the sun, which you can check out all the live streams over at joindota.com. Let's jump ourselves inside the game. We are just waiting for a couple of the players to load in, and actually now we're just waiting for the spectators. We did have ourselves a small delay before we started, as I said. We were waiting for Grunt. Grunt had some issues with his PC. That has now all been worked out. So hopefully nothing goes wrong during the game. Holy Master, because he's the man, he's our admin in charge. DHMS, you see his name. That's Dennis Holy Master Schumacher. Well done. Okay, he's just trying to troll all the viewers. Spectators load in, so let's jump ourselves inside the drafting stage. Because just to give you a bit of a history on these teams, J4T, of course, a team which got a lot of respect recently, also because of the way they combined their roster with a couple of stand-ins and managed to bring down Na'Vi because they used Leaf from Panzer. And, they had themselves some amazing plays, and that was, we're going to go back to the Na'Vi game when they played against them, and we saw the Darkseer come out. So it's interesting to see how that's going to work out in this game. Both the teams were trolling each other inside the chat before the game actually started, going, oh, man, you play Darkseer? So it was like, yeah, 20 times, solo mid, all our last games, Darkseer. That's what we did. But this time around, I hardly doubt he's going to get himself into the pool. At least he might get in the first three, but it's always risky picking him up in the first three. I'm sure MTW have thought about this and will have themselves some bans worked out. As Sindarin actually bans out Chen to start with, not really a big surprise here. As far as MTW go, they hate Chen and they hate Anti-Mage. They are their two most hated heroes. They're happy to let a Broodmother through. They're happy to let heroes like that as well as Lich come through. Those they can deal with. But they just cannot deal with a Chen. They just don't like it. Every single game they play against a Chen, there's always something that goes horrendously wrong. It's why they don't like playing up against Team Shakira, now known as Western Wolves, because Western Wolves also beat MTW in the recent D2E group stage, which was played just 2 nights ago. At least MTW's group stage was. And MTW actually found themselves out of D2E. They got knocked down, and, it was a bit of a surprise to everybody. So MTW, they're really trying to find their form. And, of course, their first match of the group stage, the second group stage for the defense. Also, we lost, MTW lost that as well. So at this point, they're tied at the bottom of the ladder of the group, which is not where they want to be. As far as J4T go, I'm just going to bring them up on my side as well. J4T are actually Crackle is coming back again. J4T is also in exactly the same position. So J4T is 0-1 in the second group stage, which is not exactly where they want to be either, but it is only one game. So SK Panzer and Western Wolves, they've all gone through in the top slots. And they're going to be, well, obviously, happy about their position, but it's still only one game. They have another 4 games to play. You must play 5 games in total before we have our final results. So there's Lich being banned out by MTW. Really a lot of time being taken in these in this banning stage. Profit the ban out from Kev, which means Sindarin can either pick up his Nightstalker or he can look at the Broodmother. That's also an option. They're the two heroes which will normally make their way into this first stage of the banning, but they have not made it in this time around. So MTW just playing just a little bit more of the line of we want to grab Lich. They will still grab up the Nightstalker, so Sindarin will grab that Nightstalker. We can't really say MTW's win rate is 100% with that Nightstalker, because Sindarin, he was playing on the radiant side last time he played up with that Nightstalker, and that was in his first match for those group stages back in the D2E tournament. And, at that point, he just did not get the start he needed. And that's always the biggest thing whenever you play a Nightstalker. You can't use that first nighttime cycle to farm. And most of the time, you want to have the support come in on that lane. Generally, it's the safe lane that Nightstalker will farm up on. And they look for the ganks early on. That way, you get a gank during the daytime and you have your items like an urn or boots or something along those lines where you can go out and gank during the first nighttime phase. Because that's your critical moment to gank. Then in this case, we'll see if Sindarin can do it, and we'll jump ourselves over to the Radiant side where they did pick up that Broodmother who got through the pool, and he'll be joined by a Venomancer. So there's a lot of pushing potential out from Kev's lineup right now, or I should say J4T's lineup. Kev is the captain for them, or at least the drafter for them. But to have Venomancer as well as Brood, so pushing power on the side lane. because you can always run that solo hero as well. That's the greatest thing about a Broodmother. It's not always the fact that Broodmother can push. Oh, Losar. We're going to have Darkseer going at J4T this time around. And he's a safe pickup as well. So Darkseer and SK, or Windrunner, we can go with that as well. Nice counters when it comes to the Broodmother. Broodmother's going to pull those Spirelings back the second that Iron Shell comes out. And also not a bad way for Nightstalker to dive. You got to remember that combination. Nightstalker already has a lot of movement speed during the nighttime. Surge him up and have an Iron Shell on him. He'll get in close. He'll get in tight. And he can chase down almost any hero. Actually, he will chase down any hero on the map. Nobody can run from that Nightstalker with the combination of Seer and NS. The only downside for it going this way is you've now got yourself two melee heroes that need a decent amount of farm. So we either have to see Seer go inside the jungle or we see him go inside a lane. But more of that will be revealed as we go a little bit further through the drafting stage. Looking over towards the Radiant side, they've still got one more pick to go. And we'll see if they're going to go support, if they're going to go like side lane solo or something along those lines. And now I know they've got to deal with the Darkseer. So they don't want to grab a hero which is too heavy on the carry. I'm thinking like DK. If they think along the lines of like a DK or a Faceless Void or something like that, Darkseer is just going to copy that. So they've got to remember they've got to try and deal with that too. So DK will now go out of the pool for Kev. He won't want to think about that. But he'll want to find other heroes that can do that job. So we'll just take a moment while Kev eats into his extra time. Really try and think about this third pick. Does he just grab a raw support? Because Syndrome's also got to think about his next stage of banning. At this point, he knows he could be dealing with a full push lineup. Earthshaker, so he will grab the support. He'll grab the support and also teamfight capability. While the illusions might not stack up that ultimate, they will actually spread out the effect of the ultimate. So that's one thing to think about when Darkseer goes up. So ES, if you look at the discussion boards, I know there's been a couple of guys over at the Joined Dota forums just talking about how do we counter a Darkseer, and Earthshaker's come up a couple of times during those conversations. So we might see if we can have ourselves a bit of a lesson. Enigma is now banned out for MTW. Not a bad ban considering Kev just loves to play it whenever he's not picked up. But that would have also added a lot of our team fight. In fact, a crap load more team fight. You'll have the Venomancer ultimate, the Earthshaker ultimate, and then you'll have Enigma's ultimate on top of that. And then the pushing power from the conversions. But in this case, that's not going to happen. He is banned out. Crystal Maid have been banned out by Kev as well. It's a very mana-intensive lineup for MTW, but generally when they try and go up... who's asking who is T-Seeker? He was known as Ticker, but because I couldn't say his name correctly, T-C-K-R, that's Ticker. But because we kept making a joke about it the other night, he decided to officially change his name to T-Seeker. 10 seconds. Which we were down with. We were happy with that. He's had it for the last couple of games as well. All right, one last ban for MTW. It's a hard thing for them to do. They ban out the jungle hero, but they don't know. There's no real hard carry that Kev will look to pick up. There's nothing along those lines. At this point, he'll probably be thinking about some form of DPS hero. The only other choice I think he might want to look at is... he won't even want to ban out Faceless Void. He's going to take out Morana. I think Void might be a thing if they want to go for the full team fight. That Void will stall up Kev's team more than help them. That's because ES wants to blink himself in and then drop the ultimate. But that's not going to help. So Shadow Shaman as well as Morana being banned out. Shadow Shaman, surprising the Radiant might not even thought about going for that. They still need a solo mid, but they also realize they don't have first pick. And Shadow Shaman's a great way of stopping those Spiderlings, just basically lay off a shock, destroys with the Spiderling wave, throw down those wards, put pressure on the Tier 1 tower. And MTW really have nothing against that right now. They don't have some instant counter push. The Iron Shell does damage over time. Windrunner's Power Shot will help out with that. Nightstalker is more single-focused. Vengeful Spirit support here for MTW. So they're not wanting to show anything until their last one, giving Kev only one hero to counter the final Dire hero. And then we'll find out how the Dire want to play this. If we see them, if Darkseer goes jungle or not, we're not going to know until they pick up their fifth and final hero. So the Radiant have two picks to go, eating through it. Not eating into the extra time, though. So is that... What are you guys on about the dancing intro? I don't know what you guys are talking about in the IRC. If you want to join it, by the way, if you're tuning into the live stream, you want to join the guys who are having a chat, and girls. Actually, we have a lot of girls who chat in the IRC as well. That's not a reason to go to the IRC. The reason to go to the IRC is to talk about Dota. But it's on Quakeness, hashtag join Dota if you want to join in. And if you're tuning in from join Dota anyway, all you got to do is just hit the button saying show chat or pop out chat, and you can bring it up pretty easily. So now 18 seconds. Kev's going to make a decision. He doesn't want to eat in too much of his extra time because he's not going to have that much time. AA is going to be the pickup, which means the pipe is going to be rushed by someone on the Dire side, ASAP, which could set it back a little bit because we have seen a lot of games of recent times where the farm doesn't get up on the support. So I'm thinking about Darks here and VS. If they don't get the amount of farm they need, then Windrunner is forced to get the pipe as well as the mech, and well, Cinderin's going to avoid that at all costs. He does not want to have that happen.
10 seconds remaining.
Stop talking. Damn, the guys in the IRC chats are horrendous.
5 seconds remaining.
Oh, man. On the bright side, that last pick that's going to come out from Kev is going to be very, very fast. 12 seconds of extra time. Yeah, nothing at all. Absolutely nothing at all. But the Dire need to pick up theirs. Who do they want? Who's going to be the damage dealer? It's going to be Weaver, so we're going to have a little bit of negative armor added to the aura stack already. No, they're all going to come out, but Weaver. Does that mean they're going to try and force a Slardar pick out of the Radiant? Because that might also be an option for the Radiant side. They've already got two supports if they want to. In fact, they've got three if you technically look at it that way. Broodmother's going to go the solo. AA, you assume to be solo mid. And then the ES, Venno, roaming and ganking. That's another option. And they just need one counter ganker. And that's going to be more than likely Slardar. So I don't know if Cinderin set this up. Or if Kev thinks along the lines of a Riki Maru. Go for a little bit more damage. And that wouldn't be completely out of the book for J4T. They've only got 5 seconds to go. 3 seconds. Bounty Hunter. So he's going to go the Invis crit. So he's going to come back with the Invis. I was thinking Invis crit through the Stealth Assassin. And I was mainly thinking that too because the amount of slow you'll get from it. But instead, we're going to have Bounty Hunter, which means that Dire's also going to have a very hard time keeping up with the money. Bounty Hunter, one of those guys where now it's a global gold increase if everybody's ganking, and especially it's a little bit more gold, the Bounty Hunter. But it gives them that trackability, so it gives them what Slardar would have done for them anyway, just not with Amplified Damage, it's with a gold bonus. So you track those targets, so it doesn't matter if Weaver goes Invis, Bounty Hunter will be keeping very, very close eyes, and it's going to be Cinderin playing. And I think this is the first time ever MTW picked up a Night Stalker and Cinderin's not playing it. So Cinderin will be playing as the Weaver, Grunt will be playing as the Night Stalker, which leaves Karandi playing as Windrunner, Matrim playing as Vengeful Spirit, and then that leaves Peppy as our final one as Darkseer. And then jumping down towards the Radiant side, we have Jing Jang Hu. I'm going to call you Jing. You know it's Jing for J4T. He's playing the Earthshaker. Actually, yeah, that is. Oh, man. Also, a little bit of lag coming out on the server tonight. I'm going to wait for that. RMN, he'll be playing as the Broodmother, going to go the solo bot, so a safe lane solo on the bottom. Kevy playing as the Ancient Apparition, more than likely solo mid. Yeah, Earthshaker's going to rotate up towards the top, and it'll be T-Seeker. He'll be playing as the Venomancer on top, and they'll be supporting Fire on the top lane. So the ping's already coming out, wanting to look at the runes. That lag is a little bit weird with it coming out. We'll go with it. Hopefully it doesn't last. Just spiking up a little bit. Now, bottom tri lane. Looking at it for MTW. It's a quick pause of the game. Kev needs a second. He doesn't have any intel of what's happening around here. But we'll have VS as well as Karonity coming down towards the bottom lane to support Cinderin. So a triple range on that bottom. Have they got sentry wards as well? No, they do not. We've got Smoke up, and we've got Observer Wards, so they can stop the pull. So they're assuming Broodmother's going to be up on that top lane, and that's going to be something for Peppy, and that's why Peppy's up on the top lane. So MTW have already got their lanes the wrong way around. They're now going to realize they're going up against a Broodmother on the bottom, and I'll be like, oh, hang on. And that's because they didn't really scout it down. They haven't had a walk down this far, and they won't see the web that was planted pretty early by RMN.
The
battle. And that's because they've just been waiting for that rune. So the 0 minute rune, and they get it on the bottom lane. It's a regen, so that's not going to help anybody. Wildfire's watching the top. Obviously, you can't regen when you're at full. And Brewmother dropping the web down, so now they know that's revealed off as well. Here in the trees goes Cinder and playing the wall, so they can't do the pull. And this lane would have worked perfectly for MTW if it wasn't the Broodmother. So right now, they need to get sentries down the bottom lane. Then they can be aggressive on the Brood, really shut him down. And Darkseer, well, he'll just have to do it the hard way. So you got six tangos and a healing salve as well as a sound shield. So either they swap their lanes up right now, because the build that Darkseer has gone for is the one that puts him on the front lines up against the Brood. So Brood takes it. Brood will deal that damage to him, and he'll be like, yep, cool. I'll just pop off a couple of consumables. I'll be hunky-dory from that point. But in this case, he can't come close to fire, because fire's going to do a lot of damage to him anyway. And even if he does come close to fire, fire will just, well, go in, Viz. But using that dark, that iron shell, maybe can keep that harassment going. Problem is, he's got T-Seeker to deal with. So moving himself inside around the trees. Nice little play there by Pepe. Realized that T-Seeker will have the advantage if he walks right. So he came back into where the creep wave is. And T-Seeker's going to be really careful right now. Pepe is still here. And the support is coming in from Coronity, who will now be heading towards the top lane. So we are having a bit of a lane switch up. And there's our sentry ward. So they were instantly flown in by the VS. Bringing them down towards the bottom lane. The courier just arrives back at base from doing his job. So they can keep eyes on this Broodmother. So it's a good switch up here from MTW. They give a range hero towards the top lane. That way T-Seeker doesn't have all the control. If Bounty Hunter comes out, Karani can harass, and Karani can also pull. There's a ward sitting on the side, which is going to make that a little bit difficult. That does make Fire think twice about coming up this close. He's got to think a little bit more cautiously. If he stays in that close, he's going to find him copying a lot of harassment. He's only got one tango charge left as well as the south. And while he can get a tango charge off Venoman, so he's also pretty low as it is. And that's just the damage they've been taking from the Iron Shell. Center and seeing the Spiderlings. Try and chase down Matrim. It's going to be very, very hard to do when those sentry wards are up. And also just using a bit of ranging here. Just something for Araman. He realized if he leaves his creep wave, these Spiderlings up here, while yes, he can harass with them, it also shows him just how much vision is there, and Pepe will come top, bottom. So this is the way the lanes were meant to be. So the Iron Shell, and there's that counter. And because there's vision, they might even look for a first blood here. That's a lot of damage happening to him. It's from the Iron Shell, and RMN forced to munch on one of his tangos. Pepe was really thinking about going for that. And now RMN thinks about it himself. Oh, son of a first blood. They get in the middle lane. Smoke gang from the ES and the Venno. So we're starting off tonight just like we did last night. Rotation coming out towards top lane. So the Radiant looking for another kill. Syndrome and Cromani are up here. It was the middle lane. The solo for MTW that went down. And now Karani's going to be really careful. He's taking a lot of damage already. ES visual hold. Windrunner in place. Needs to pop that Windrunner up. But Teasing is going to be here with a great gal to the face. As one Shuriken toss will finish the job. Syndrom will try and do as much damage as he can before he's got to shooky himself out of that too. And will destroy off the ward so he can get himself off a salve. In fact, he's not even going to do that. He's going to use instead the tangos. Just in case fire's coming in too close. And the rotation coming again. Venno and ES, we knew they were going to rotate at some point. My eyes are too busy watching that bottom lane battle. Well, I don't understand if he's getting himself slightly intoxicated. Kev has that bottle running in mid, so he can spam off his abilities a lot more. Problem, they're going to look for their T-Seeker with boots as well. If he gets one level on that poison singer, he should be left here in the middle lane just for a second to get a couple of levels. Kev's going to take the regen room, and then he'll come back in again. Matrim was watching that. They want to know where these runes are going. Bounty Hunter's already off to a great start. He's almost level 6, and then Syndrome will hate this top lane. Syndrome knew he was going to have a hard lane nonetheless. It's just one of those lanes where you go, hang on, oh, Magic Missile on Brewmother again. Vacuum Pepe has it, but he's not going to pull RMN into it. And we're still getting those spikes in-game, so my apologies for this, but I don't know what it's coming from. Yes, Fissure from the side, and Broodmother able to do enough. Pepe is running pretty low on mana. Managed to have enough for a vacuum, and now RMN runs himself up on high. T-Seeker comes in. Pepe avoids the Gale. Bounty Hunter kills Weaver on the top lane, but we'll stick with Pepe on the bottom. See if he can get himself another kill. RMN comes in close. Pepe goes inside the trees. And at this point, J4T is all over MTW like a hot rash. Fire getting kills on the top lane. Regeneration now pops off as well. You might have to restart Dota 2 after this game or something along those lines. Not quite sure why we're getting the in-game lag. It's not even net lag. It's just in-game lag that's getting caused. Sender and Tract on the top. He's just lost all maneuverability. And they knew this was going to happen with that Bounty Hunter pick. But I didn't realize it when they picked it because the Weaver was picked up. And then Bounty Hunter was picked in return by J4T. They just knew about their lanes early on, but J4T didn't get the start they wanted. They wanted to shut down that Broodmother, who's now a level 6 with the Soul Ring and Poor Man Shield. Darkseer, well, could build almost the same, but has got himself a Soul Ring. But he'll be looking for a Vanguard instead. That way, whenever he sacrifices his life, he'll always have that regen there for himself. And he can just keep on spamming out that Iron Shell. Aeldi's flying down towards bottom lane. So should be a kill on Pepe. If Pepe doesn't move back, he will die. In fact, yes, he is dead. The shadow will work. In fact, it's just going to be a right click from Broodmother to do the job. So yet another kill for the Broodmother. This is going to speed up the Orc of the Malevolence. And this is also our first nighttime cycle, so let's see how much damage Grunt can do. Extending the nighttime, he is level 6. So he can do that. But he needs to find himself a kill. And J4T doing the wise thing they can do. They've had a great early game. And MTW are on the back foot. Not by as much as you'd think. 750 gold is nothing for 6 kills. That is really, really surprising. But that is massively surprising. What is our farm on Syndra and Pepe? 27 for 8 versus Bounty Hunter, who is 27 for 6. So the farm is equal, even though the kill did go to fire. Meanwhile, on the bottom lane, now the initiation's going to go. They've got the sentry down again. This should be a kill on the RMN. They knew he was going to run his way out of the tower. One more void. The surge goes on, and that's that combo I was talking about. Bounty Hunter does kill off the Vengeful Spirit. But it's the kill on the Broodmother was just more important, a support or a side lane solo. It's that combo for Grunt to dive and get kills. And now Syndra's in trouble. He's currently tracked, and even if he does go in Shuki, he's going to be able to phase himself out. Yes, movement speed is what's going to save his life. But he gets back to that tower. Shackle shot latches Kev to a creep, and then Kev able to move just a little bit far enough away that the power shot didn't have its full effect, and grunts in too close to the tower, and the cold feet. He could not walk in a direct path out of there. And Karani is forced to move himself out, and Kev gets the kill. He also has that ultimate back up again, so he's going to use it in just a moment to kill off Karani. Veno and ES coming in towards the middle lane. Now they see him rotating top. Oh, the Fissure. Wait for it. Cold feet. Fissure will go. You won't even need to use the ulti. Karani gets one last right hit from Earthshaker. And his paw is pretty close. That was a close range attack. And now the gold gravel starts spiking up a little bit more. But I want to check it out CS. So at this point, 31 for Syndra. It's a 44 for 2 for Darkseer, which is really impressing me, to the 33 for 6 for the Broodmother. A lot of it will come from Spiling, so it'll be more about the gold earned per minute. And RMN, 303. And Pepe at 279. So the CS is higher, but the gold is a lot less. And that's the little thing deceiving. So if you guys are from the Warcraft 3 era, you kind of know about the CS scores and that. They're divvied up between... Pepe, he even gets blocked in by his own creep wave. But yes, you'll know that, Pepe. You were so lucky you have enough mana for a surge. You're just going to hold on to this mana. Trying to harass RMN back, but Venomancer is here, so Spiraling charge into him. And RMN, now he knows he's not being attacked. There's no vision here. Earthshaker will look for the Fissure. Fissure will go, surge has already happened, so Darkseer decides to run the only way he can, and that's down. But he's still going to die with one other Spiraling charge going into his chest. And Fire setting up for a kill on Syndra, and AALD will fly in. Oh, Syndra's not ready for this. He gets hit by it too. And then time-lapses the damage out. But look at that crit. Crit from Fire. The first thing came out from the Jinder coming out of the smoke. Wow, the Ghost Walk. Well, I'm hearing a shackle going. It's the dive on mid. Void on Ancient Apparition. ES Fissure once again in the perfect position. Grunt start the tower too far again. One right click will not be enough, but Karani's also stuck. Will get the power shot, but will lose his own life. The cold feet dealing off the damage to get the last hit. So the trade-off, and that's only the second kill for MTW now. And Pepe trying to hold the bottom. Bounty Hunter. Well, you don't even know when he's going to kill somebody. The crit he's going to have, especially on a Weaver who's got very, very little life and very little armor. He'll just die instantly. Weaver's got 700 life, and you look at Fire, with now level 3 on the Jinda. Bonus damage plus 200%. He's already dealing about, well, you do the math for 85, 95 damage. So 200% bonus, and then the toss of 250. He can kill Offential Spirit with two hits. That's just the insane killing power. Now Shaker now getting himself some levels in mid. We'll get his Echo Slam now. So J4T spreading out the XP. Cinderin coming in too. Because he has completely revealed. Look at the crit. Two swipes. Cinderin holding onto the time-lapse for the moment. Just shooking himself away. It's good to see them with the ward up here on the top lane. So if Fire does decide to go in, they could find themselves with a kill. They need to reveal him. There goes the dust. And the grunt will go for the first void. Aeldi is flying up. But there should be a kill for MTW. But no, Venomancer comes in with the Gale. Aeldi flew up towards the top lane. Just niggling on Sin as it flew over the top of his head. Meanwhile, back in the middle lane, Karani's going to get ganked off too. ES really being in the midst of all these fights. Kev, wouldn't he wish he had his ultimate right now? Less off the Vortex. Actually stopping the regen of Karani. And Kev's going to dive this. He's got bottle charges so he can do so. And Karani missing the power shot. He couldn't really get the line. Had forced pop his wind run so he can get himself away fast enough that the cold feet stopped having his effect. Because cold feet does that damage before it freezes. And that damage was almost enough to kill off Windrunner. But Windrunner going the long, long way around. He's fearing that AA ulti from Kev. But Kev's going to try and get his timing right for this. In fact, no, he's not. He's just not even going to care about it. He's going to go for bottom lane. Pepe thought he was going to be safe. Aeldi, it's just short. Couple of seconds is what he needed. And that would have been a guaranteed death there on Pepe on the bottom lane. And that's just that global presence of Ancient Apparition. It's why everyone, he turned into a bit of a support hero into tri-lanes a couple of weeks ago. And then in a couple of days ago, he turned into this mid-solo hero again. He's always been able to do that role. Ferrari 430 for me was always the best Ancient Apparition I ever saw. He performed at the Malaysian tournament, beating down the team formerly known as Scythe. And that was when Roy and Koi were playing back together again. Back in ye old days. Say ye old days, it was actually the start of last year. And that was some amazing play for an Ancient Apparition, but in this case, it's just not the case. I mean, it is the case. He's playing a Ferrari 4-3 OAA, solo mid. Fire. Setting up for the top. Track now goes on Matrim. Matrim can see Fire, though. So if he needs to stun him, he should. Yes. And there's a sentry ward, so they know what's going on. Get rid of that sentry. Sin gets fissured for a second, but that's why he has that ring. Trying to region up, and Karani TPing in a spotter because the track is on Matrim. And Sindarin also realized there's a sentry ward on the top now. Not that he really needs it. It's just when Fire comes out of Invis, he'll want to throw. And Fisher to start up. Crit 1, crit 2. Gale, time lapse out from Cinderin. Still getting tracked. Good stun. Grey Shackle on Bounty Hunter. Not chaining off exactly correctly. Earthshaken now. See how Bling just walked in there and threw the Oldman down. Aeldi will fly up. That's almost going to be the death of Karani if he takes any more damage. Fire, they want to get that kill. They get it too. Fisher, Shackle holds T-Seeker to a tree. Does sacrifice Windrunner's life to do so, but VS comes back in with another stun. Venomancer War still dealing a little bit of damage there to Matrim, so he's got to get rid of those little suckers. The 2-for-1 trade, that's the first fight which has gone MTW's way. And even then, Syndrome's going to be really careful. Kev is diving this too far in. He's going to go for Syndrome. The track is going to wear off. And Kev can't see him. The silence, the stun needs to come in from Matrim, but he has no mana for this. So they've got to do it with normal right click. Syndrome's going to be really careful. He's got one more Shooky up his sleeve. And Darcy gets the kill. Vacuum and right click. MTW take a 3-for-1 trade as far as fights go, and Pepe goes down towards the bottom lane trying to stop that bottom push on the tier 1 tower. That's the first tier 1 tower to go down, but MTW, they gain themselves a little bit back now as that line just starts to level a little bit. And with the tower going down, it will start to spike up again. Iron Man getting a lot of farm on that bottom lane. And this continuous harassment on Pepe means he can't stay in close. He'll be forced to put that iron shell on somebody else. And they'll just push the wave out, and Broodmother won't really mind that too much. That means when he tries to push hard as well, well, it just gets countered. Yes, thank you, Holy Master. I've already been counting the spotlings. We've been through that, Holy! You were not listening, man! You were not listening! Then we talked about the difference in the gold per minute versus the RCS. Well done, Holy. Hey, he'll do a fly down towards the bottom lane. Darcy needs to go left. Surges up. Oh, he might shatter if they can get one last hit on Pepe. But they can't do so. Sparklings are trying to. The dust will pop, and now they're going to look for the Broodmother. The silence up on him. He's already used his insatiable hunger, which will wear off. But Brood running back very, very fast. And Pepe will get to live, but where is this ancient look? Go, the Spiderling. They're still going to dive it. AA ulti's on cooldown again. That's because he tried to use it for the first initiation. And that's why you're seeing Pepe using those surges. Get back to base as fast as you can. But the Vanguard will let him live through these situations now. So Darkseer has what he needs to live.
Invisibility.
What is this? Toby just got pawned by Holy. You guys are in the IRC. You were shooting him from when I went on that. Damn you to hell. middle lane set up. Grunts with an invis rune. Coming in close, lets off the silence on the Earthshaker. Howl goes out as well. Gale shackling Earthshaker to a tree. Magic missile stun. They'll manage to pick themselves up in the ES. Karani's in a little bit of trouble. He's got to fall himself back faster. The Vortex is there, but up the hill. T-Seeker lets off his ultimate, but he's going to die as well. Grunt retreats out, realizing Cold Feet's on top of him. With a double kill for the Nightstalker, and Cinderin's going to look for the Ancient Apparition as well. Grunt comes back in again. Fear no evil, fear no poison. Ensign Apparition will go down. Cinderin time-lapse out the damage, as well as the track. And Cinderin just gets himself out with a little bit of speed. Wants to get away from that bounty hunter. Does not want to be tracked. He does not want J4T knowing what lanes he's moving in between. But some great fighting coming on here from MTW. And by surprisingly, they're trying to pick the fights during the daytime. Diving down tier 1 towers, finding the blood, and having J4T slightly overextend in some situations. So 3k gold was the advantage, but you're now going to look dire. That's all of the points for him. And that's also going to give them some time in the lane, so Cinderin's going to take that time to farm up on the top. Get some XP, get some gold. Karani. He's looking pretty lean on items as well. What are we looking for, Grunt? Smoke and treads. This shows you the kind of life Darkseer has had. He's going to come back to the main base, though, and spend that 1k gold he's got. Matrim. Well, for his eventual spirit, he's not looking too bad for 18 minutes. And then Pepe with the Soul Ring and Vanguard. So he is basically the best farmed hero for MTW right now. Should reveal, yeah, 105. 103 for RMN. He's almost completed that Orc at the Malevolence. How the Terror try and slow down the bottom. Earthshaker, he has Arcane Boots. ALT again. Just a little bit short there from Kev. I don't know if he thought the Darkseer was going to run, VS going to run off to the left. But Brew will continue to pressure this bottom lane. But while that Howl of Terror keeps flying out, the negative armor brings his creep waves down faster when they come in range of the tower. Tappy now heads up towards the top lane, where Bounty Hunter is continuing to get farm. He's also going to go the Battle Fury build. Not always sure I agree with the Battle Fury build. It gives a lot of extra damage towards the Bounty Hunter when he gets his farm up. But it's that whole thing. It's the same with the whole Anti-Mage build. When do you want to be that powerhouse? And if you want to go late in the game, Bounty Hunter, if he gets caught out, if he gets revealed by Dust, if he gets silenced, Weaver can deal off the job if he gets enough damage himself. Pepe, trouble on top. Needs to surge out of here. Needs to surge out of here right now. There we go. On the run, he is currently tracked. But Pepe taking a lot of damage. If T-Seeker got there in time, Pepe would not be able to get out of there. He would have taken too much damage. And now MTW go for a hump, but they're walking straight past sentry wards. Is that seen by Kev? Kev's going to know this is coming. They walked past his own wards. The silence is going, so Kev elapsed in moment in concentration. Finds himself getting ganked out, and MTW getting themselves what is basically a free kill. It's the Radium Wards watching that bottom, not MTWs. You can always tell us the green ones as opposed to the red ones.
Illusion.
Green for Radiant, red for Dire.
Radiant tower is under attack. Radiant structures are fortified.
Syndrome now going one-on-one with RMM. He'll prefer that battle a lot more. Because he can take that battle. We're also taking a tier 1 tower in middle lane is what MTW is going to do. And our last hit goes to our Vengeful Spirit. More money for him, so he can complete up his treads, but he should be looking towards getting that mech. Well, we're going to see that from Windrunner. Considering Matrim's got the last hit, he'll probably be the one to look for the mech. But Syndrome now with the Vitality. But Brood does get that Orchid. And that's really going to shut down in fact, any hero. But it's mainly meant for Syndrome. They want to deal more damage faster, and they want to have that silence so Syndrome can't move, he can't time-lapse. And now this time they spot Karate moving through. Gale, Shackle, Latches, T-Seeker. Yet again, another kill. Set up and got via MTW. Well, now Matrim gets rid of these wards. If he can. Wow, that mischance is really raping him. But Matrim would have been like, hang on. They had a sentry and an observer here? What the hell, man? Having revealed off, Aldi's got flying down towards the bottom lane. He's going to hit here on Syndrome. He just revealed himself for a second. That Orchid is up as well, so Syndrome can't time-lapse yet, but that Orchid won't last forever, and there goes the time-lapse. That's one thing at this point Broodmother is missing. It's that ability to right-click, and that's just the maneuverability there of Syndrome. So Aldi wasted. Orchid the Malevolence goes on cooldown. Comes off cooldown pretty damn fast anyway. But just one of those times where Syndrome goes, yep, cool, you try to kill me, but my time-lapse is stronger. Dust flying out from Grunt. He managed to hit Bounty Hunter then. Interesting to also see later on in the game if we see an Aghanim Scepter up from Grunt with a combination of the gem. It's a nice item combo to go when you're going up against heroes who like to move around in Invis. And that's going to be Broodmother as well as Bounty Hunter. So a gem will be coming up from MTW at some time. But they need to get the life up. Oh, Peppy. This is just going to be cruel on him. All he wants to do is farm. Fire's waiting for the Iron Shield to end. Ash, he's waiting for the Aldi to fly in. First crit and hit. They can set up so easily with this. If Grun knew what was going to... Wow, sinister laugh, Bounty Hunter. Very, very sinister laugh. But if Grun knew what was going to happen, then, same thing could happen. Now he gets tracked. And it's just like, damn it. Damn it to all hell. They can see exactly where I am. But he'll still be able to damage that Tier 1 tower down a little bit. And MTW are doing a very impressive job to try and pull this game back after the insane start that J4T got Grunt. Let's off the Void on fire just in case he wants to try and chase Grunt. Well, Grunt's also got himself 1.8k. We'll see what item he wants to go next. Natrum's got to be really careful. There's a Radiant Sentry here. And he doesn't know that. So if he comes in with that Invis rune, they might find that kill. Still getting the in-game lag. So my apologies for this, but I do not know why. It's not your stream lagging, so do not panic. Or unless you're watching the 240 or 360p. They're still having services, like being upgraded. It should continue for another week. Let's check out Goldcraft. Where MTW managed to level this again. They've come back of the 3k gold that they were missing, and now Darkseer is looking to build up a pipe. And he's not too far off doing it. Mech is trying to get up for Karate, and that's going to basically cancel out any effect that AA's been having on them. And also the effect of the Venomancer Ultimate. With just two items, you can do that job. Bounty Hunter in the meantime with a blade. Might see a Diffuser coming out from him. Diffuser is what I'll assume he's going to be looking at. Wants to get rid of that mana off Weaver as fast as he can, so Weaver doesn't have that maneuverability. But he's going to go Yasha instead, so we're going to see Mantisar coming out from Bounty Hunter. Let's see the Tier 1 tower going. Actually, Grunt, as well as Peppy, want to go this. Earthshaker lands off a fissure. Broodmother destroys all the trees, so we're getting close. Echo Slam will start this off too. And the Void trying to still bring down the Earthshaker. Matrim lit up a Howl of Terror, but the Aeon is going to fly in perfectly. Wall comes up. There's a lot of heroes in a fight against Broodmother's fighting against himself, but he still brings down the Nightstalk as well as the Darkseer. As now the track is on the Ventral Spirit. ES lands off the fissure. It's all the illusions of Darkseer. They're currently chasing down the Earthshaker, but there is something real in the middle of it all. And a Cinderin who gets a kill. No, before Bounty Hunter kills off his teammate's Windrunner. Ventral Spirit trying to retreat out. Throws out the Sunland Bounty Hunter. I could kill you. Wow, this lag is really, really annoying. Tower is under it. Dire's top tower has fallen. Cinderin critted. Needs a time-lapse. Does do so. But has no mana for a Shuki. Uses his stick charges, but it's still not helping him. Fire. Tanking up the tower. Really wants this kill. Aeldi will fly in here to go in front of Cinderin. It's going to hit him. Fire needs a Shuki toss. Gets it as well. And Cinderin goes down. Brought to justice. It's a great fight there for J4T. MTW is slowly bringing themselves back into this game. But that's our first 5v5 fight we've really had. And J4T managed to take it, and that just spins all the hard work MTW have been working towards out the window. So 2.5k is now the difference between them. But MTW will try and hold on. They will not give up. They still realize the more powerful Brewmother gets. Well, I'm seeing Earthshaker taking a lot of damage. That's because Nightstalker's killing him. Oh, you gotta love the nighttime. Void TP, you got a TP coming from AA. Looking for the cold feet, we'll get it as well. Grunt decides, you know what, I can tank this. All I need is one Void hit on Earthshaker, but if I don't have enough life, I can't get it. Venomancer with a Gale gets it. And Grunt goes in too far. Trying to get the kill on the Earthshaker, managed to bite the Blink Dagger before that as well. An overextension, Veno at the right time, and a good TP in from AA. Maybe just a choice there from NS. He was locked in no matter what he tried to do. And yes, I realize this is Red Bull, so we're in dangerous territory. Haste. So now Cinderin still trying to get a little bit more farm up on himself. Looks like he's going to go BKB. Just try and live through these fights, but he's still not being that damage dealer. It's a lot of life he's getting. RMN gets revealed out. He knows there's a sentry ward now because he's taking up that damage. Even if he is invis. But he's also got himself a lot of life regen that's going to be coming out from that web. Now Grunt's going again. Pops the dust. He's now going to spot off two heroes down here and realizes he's well in over his head. Grunt needs to get out. The fissure is not going to let him do so. So Grunt dying two times in the space of 1 minute. Aeldi will fly in as well. It's a little bit off target, but it's still his Cinderin who walked very, very close to the trees. You know, time lapse out the damage, but that's another 50 seconds. He now does not have that. And the counter ward happened from the Radiant side. Now they have the vision. MTW realized this too because their ward was destroyed because of it. ES! Up the side, blinks in. Echo Slam VS swapping Cinderin out. Knows there's another time-lapse and Cinderin's going to live through this. Vacuum up. Needs that wall. Wants to pop it off but cannot do so. There's not enough from here. Shackle shot. Long one on Earthshaker. Now the walk down from Peppy, but Peppy's going to die. Brewmother turns around, turns him into Spyless, but not before Weaver gets the kill. Missile on the run back out again, being tracked. Ancient Apparition. Follow the ulti, follow the ulti, follow the ulti, follow the ulti. In. Hit Matrim. Cinderin gets back in time, but the Vengeful Spirit should know that was coming as well. Nightstalker comes back down towards the bottom lane. He's getting sick of this Broodmother. TP support's coming in as well. Dust will pop. Karani gets himself in position so he can shackle RMN to a tree. Needs to do it right now as well, but he's silent so he can't. The Orchid is on him. And there we go. Gets the kill on the Broodmother. They need this tier 1 tower as well. MTW really need comeuppance for everything that's been happening to them. Dire's middle tower has fallen. And now they will push on the tier 1. TP support's coming down. Earthshaker is here. He has that blink and fissure. And that's really going to put a big staller in MTW. With three heroes here, there goes the fissure. Hey, blink away. He's like, hang on, Cinderin, I didn't get all three. Aeldi will fly down again. Kev really been on the mark. Hits all three heroes. Fortification will slow them down as well. Karani can do it from range. Cinderin just needs to get back. And Karani does do the job, and there comes the mech. And Cinderin gets himself out as fast as he can. VS taking out that top lane. Helping out Grunt, who has possibly... Is he the lowest farm out of all the big heroes for MTW? And check out our gold. Grunt at 274. Not looking good for him. And again, not looking for good for Darkseer either. Managed to get caught out in the middle lane. This is what happens when you check out CS. Always happens, man. Always happens. Fire's going to come up for a kill now, and Grunt. Grunt doesn't have enough life to live through this. Right click, track. More money will come in. A, Oli will fly out in just a couple of moments' time if Grunt gets himself away. Shooky toss. Grunt's got enough life, so AA will hold his ulti. Cinderin, though, catching out fire. Four heroes turn around on Bounty Hunter. He was not ready for this. AA ulti. They had to clear. They need to get away from these illusions. Cinderin will time-lapse out. Earthshaker. Oh, Karani ran up the high ground, so he can't get close enough for the Blink Fisher to do off the damage to force Karani to shatter. Still, Bounty Hunter is now down. That's a minute for him dead, but he does have that Mantra as well as Battle Fury. So he's got a lot of money. But Weaver's almost completed up his BKB. Only about 700 or so gold away. Let's up the Weaver wave, try and slow down this bottom push. Cinderin really needs to get himself up. If he can, a Radiance or something that can stop this push. Grunt comes down. He's looking for a BKB as well. Ogre Club up on him. And the tower gets denied by Cinderin. So less money for J4T, but there's still money nonetheless. So just 7.5 is almost, you'd say that's about 8k the difference. What do we got? 38.47. Yeah. 7.8. Iron Man's still going to be careful on bottom, but looks like he's going to set up for Cinderin. A-ulti again. Cinderin needs out. Silence up with the Orca so he can't time-lapse. VS swaps him out, but Cinderin's still going to time-lapse this damage. There we go. As Iron Man continues to eat on that bottom lane, more and more money flying into him. Thinking now Grunt realized he's about to be initiated on Kev. Blink up, Fissure will hold him in place, so the Cold Feet will channel. Echo Slam as well, Weaver will hurl out the wave. And he's going to look for an extra rebuttal kill. Needs one too, Howl of Terror. Only hits there on T-Seeker as well as Kev, but the support was too far away. But once again, Grunt gets caught out in the lanes, just trying to get a little bit of farm during the daytime. BKB is now up on Broodmother. No one on MTW really has enough damage to deal with him. They're having to go very, very defensive. Even, Weaver's got himself the Vanguard and Ogre Axe. There's no right-click power. Peppy at this point can turn around on him if he manages to grab himself. I want to click on Peppy, thank you. Peppy gets tracked. But Peppy, he can slow Broodmother down, then he can replicate Broodmother. But that doesn't really help you if you can't deal off damage from your other heroes. Like, you can copy everybody else, and that's going to help you total up a crap load. But Weaver needs farm. Nice Orca needs to be able to survive when it comes to fight, so he needs to complete up that BKB, which he's not going to do if he keeps getting picked off in the lanes. Cinderin. We find him mid, especially now he has that BKB. Just watch when he has to push it off. BKB, one of these things. It's not the be-all and end-all of items if you go into the later part of the game. This is a 10-second duration for the first charge. Oh, Roshan is killed. Ancient Apparition, that's not a real one. They know that. There's Kev. Aeoli will fly in. Peppy, just searching himself away. The fact that Roshan is dead. You can find that Aegis the Immortal on the Broodmother. Looking for Cinderin as well. They have themselves a ward up right now, so if they want to go for the kill on the Broodmother, they can do so. The problem is they also have a lot of heroes who are... Oh, Grunt, again. Grunt can't take this. He knows this. Needs to get out. Oh, he moved! It was the toss! The toss and the stun! Oh, nice talk. I thought he was going to get out of that one. Well, that was a cooldown. 10 seconds. So he basically needed to wait for that toss, but he took the risk, got tossed up, got stunned. Couldn't get the TP out then. Popped the ultimate to try and escape. But now he's got 40 seconds on the sideline, a wasted ultimate. Here in the Weaver Wave, latch on the bottom. Counter warning still coming out. This gem build is never going to work for a Night Stalker. VS now comes in. Earthshaker blinks. Fissure as well as Echo Slam. Fire is, however, locked to a tree, but Karani cannot fight this one forever. Wind runs on cooldown. Aeoli will fly in. It's a little bit too late. Gale hits on Karani. And look at the crit now. Too many slices. Fire has just too much damage. That's causing too many issues for MTW. Matrim throws down the sentry ward so he can at least keep some form of vision. And Fire just walks down to the tier 2 tower. Pepe continues to farm up. He's almost, well, actually has the recipe for the pipe. He needs to bite up the headdress, gets it as well, so that's completely done. Pipe is now up for MTW. That's going to help them during the fights, but they've got to stop getting picked off. That's where Bounty Hunter's strength does come in. It's the reason why it's happening to MTW as well. You can't just go, oh, our MTW, just, oh, you're getting caught out all the time. I'm not trying to say that. Bounty Hunter is the expert at it. He goes invis, walks around, finds somebody. AO gets the ulti right. ES blinks in with a fissure. Whoops, hello. Vacuum in. He's trying to pull in those sparlings to damage them down, but there's that AA ulti again. And Matrim gets dropped down very, very low, forces the pipe already. And this is not what they want, but the double TP is now going to come in. VS swapping the Broodmother in, but the cold feed's going to kill off Matrim. And Broodmother gets out. ES blinks in. Fissure holds the Windrunner together. Windrunner then latches Broodmother to a tree. Power Shot tries to go through as well. Syndrome tries to stay in nice and close, but he's going to get back. He's getting bitten up. Grunt needs to get out as well. Fire's on the hunt for this one. He doesn't have a toss. It's still on cooldown. Syndrome gets himself back out with a BKB. Shackle doesn't lash fire to anything. And a great ES Fissure holds Syndrome outside the base. He's trying to shooky himself away. And they need to track him down, but he's not tracked up just yet. In the vacuum! Sucked up the hill! Oh, there's the death of Earthshaker. He's shackled to a tree inside the base. What a great vacuum. Now the dust will pop. They reveal off fire. They want to get themselves another kill. That's revealing the illusions as well. Syndrome, he wants to get a kill. He's going to find one on Kev. Kev yielding himself up in the air, so he has a little bit of time. But in comes Darkseer, forced up sway as well. Vacuum back in again. Nice socket this time gets the last hit. Much needed gold for him. An MTW still controlling during these team fights, and that one vacuum. You got to give so much props to Pepe just then for that vacuum, pulling the Earthshaker as well as the Bounty Hunter up onto the high ground, and that Mandastar was forced to be used in defense. So he popped that off inside the main base so he could run himself away. Couldn't initiate. Earthshaker got shackled up by Windrunner 2. And the battle was just MTWs up to that point. So we still see our gold graph spiraling out of control for MTW, but it has managed to flatline a little bit up on the high. That's a big, big difference. As Pepe tries to get a little bit of extra push in that bottom. So you got to point out the fact that MTW fought that really without a VS. Like, he swapped the Broodmother in, but that was us like a, oh, Broodmother got out. That's fine. Broodmother really wasn't faced by that at all. But it was, more importantly, fought without the pipe. The pipe was swapped off very, very early by Pepe. So they could be ready for that fight. Now, Pepe. Pepe searches, but he's not going to get out. There's too many stuns. Earthshaker finishes the job. And he's getting closer and closer towards that Aghanim Scepter. In fact, he's only a grand away. Chilling touch by AA. Gives everybody so much more damage. And the push will now come onto the tier three tower in the mid. Down towards the bottom lane, Aldi will fly. Won't hit there on Grunt. BKB is already up from Broodmother. Good Fissure. Holding the support arrows out of play. Matrim now taking a lot of damage from Broodmother. And will actually get the kill, Broodmother, but then get shackles to the tree. Windrunner going to power shot through. Still not enough damage. Earthshaker trying to get in position for another Fissure. The Brood is taking up the tower. Weaver wants this kill. They can pick off Brood. They can at least pop off the Aegis. But that's why Brood's being so suicidal. Shackle latches Bounty Hunter to a Spiderling of all things. Syndrome pushed out. Needs to time-lapse this damage. He will do so, and the BKB will still hold. As RMN trying to bring down this tower. For him, it doesn't matter if he lives or dies. But Aegis was going to expire sometime soon anyway. That's why this push is now coming. But Bounty Hunter takes out the tower. The track is already on Syndrome as well as Coronity. Shackle holds RMN in place again. Just trying to slow him down. And Pepe will look for the wall. Gets the wall up. A lot of heroes trying to be brought in. Earthshaker lets off his own ultimate. Gets the kill there on Windrunner. But the Venom ulti is pretty awesome as well. Grunt's in a lot of trouble. Syndrome gets a kill on the side of the play. Picking off Kev again. But he's still being tracked up, and not to mention the ward that's there. Syndrome runs back through the wall, and then Timelapse is back through it as well. Matrim lands off the stun, just trying to stop Bounty Hunter from doing anything, but the ES Fissure locks Ventral Spirit between the barracks as well as Bounty Hunter. Another Weaver wave, just trying to slow down, trying to hold onto their bottom barracks. And the buyback from the Ancient Apparition, probably just so he can hurl off his ultimate. No, he can't. Ulti's still on cooldown. As Pepe tries to deal with the illusions which are chasing down Syndra, it's the real thing which is the bigger trouble. Sucking the heroes in. And there's the double TP out. Now the bottom barracks is gone. We'll just check that gold, almost up to 25,000. And our farm is going to be massive on fire. 226, 13 for 2 for fire. 241 for RMN. And he's managed to achieve 628. 22 assists for the Earthshaker. So he's been in 25 out of the 34 battles. And you can just see the result of MTW's teamfight as well. 17 battles. And the stats are nowhere near as enough as being there. Grunt's been involved in a lot of them, though. He's actually been involved in 14 out of the 17. So you've got to give props to Grunt for that. But Grunt's also got 116 and 8 deaths. So it is not helping him at all. Aldi flying in towards the middle lane. That's just harassment. But this time it misses everything. MTW able to be out of position for it. Pepe still wants to push out this middle lane a little bit. Get themselves a little bit of space, and they can do that with that iron shell. He doesn't need to be there, and the career will just push. Gives him a little bit of extra money. How are we looking for Grunt? Still with that Ogre Axe and can't buy it. Well, tell me that's a BKB. Sentries. Okay, that's not going to help. Nicely done, Holy Master. So people are trying to ask who the fourth player is of J4T. Jing Jung Wu. But he wants to remain secret. But the French are trying to work out who it is. Fire now with a butterfly as well as a demon edge. Once he has an MKB up, he's going to be, well, anybody is not going to have any life. Just the summary of what's going to happen. Baby's going to enjoy this. Iron Shell, vacuum everybody together. He wants these spidlings though. He doesn't just want the creep wave, he wants the spidlings to come in. He's not going to get it though. But he throws out another iron shell. Kedra says, get that guy away from me. Which means now the iron shell's on cooldown just for a little bit longer. And now the push will come on the top lane. Question will be, will the tower be the result? Cinderin getting tracked up. So he's lost his maneuverability already. And Iron Shell is still causing some issues. ES Fissure. Cinderin needs a time lapse. He's going to get silenced. VS swaps him up. Now the wall comes down from Darkseer. And this is not where J4T want to be. There's too many heroes now. Venomancer pops off the ultimate, hitting on all the MTW boys. But the pipe is up. RMN needs to do off a little bit more damage. Fire is trying to do it. He's going to find Grunt. Look how much damage he has to Grunt. Cinderin needs to get himself out as well. He bought himself a little bit of crit, trying to counter off to Fire's damage. But look how much damage Fire is doing. It's a double kill for him, but can they get him down? Yes, they can. The stun will go. They get the kill. They hold their barracks on the top. And Bouncing Hunter hurls his money away, buying back into the game. Two heroes down for MTW. Ancient Apparition managed to live through that, but that was just the power of the Darkseer ulti. And it wasn't even an Aghanim Scepter. Just that wall holding on. And Matrim will take care of the middle lane. Again, my apologies for the in-game lag. Matrim walk to the side. Oh, he's dead. Shatter. Yes. There was the hopefulness that VS would live. That way the MTW wouldn't be completely outnumbered for the next fight. Not to also mention Roshan's dying again. So just watch Bounty Hunter destroy him. All the damage which is being done right now is being done by Fire. Kev is just helping out with a little bit of support. But the Aegis Immortal goes on Bounty Hunter. He will just dive and look for kills now. On the bright side for MTW, if they manage to clone up Bounty Hunter, the amount of damage that he will do to the opposition is pretty fun. And that could be just a problem for J4T to look at. AALT flies in towards the bottom lane, but it's not going to do anything. The damage that comes out from fire. The entire creep wave dies in three hits. I don't care if there's a telephone. You don't answer that, man. You don't answer that. Just a reminder, too, for everybody who's still tuning in. Still tuning in, that's right. You're just like, oh, I'm tuning out for a moment. We do have another match coming up tonight, our last match of the night. It's supposed to start in 11 minutes' time, and that is Dignitas versus Mouse Sports. So the matchup from D2E, which happened during their group stages, and Dignitas, who went 0-3 in that, Mouse Sports also unable to advance in that group stage. Both teams being knocked out will now face up against each other in the next matchup. We'll see if Come With Me will join them this time, or if he'll be live streaming himself playing matchmaking instead. So we'll check out that roster when it happens. But for Dignitas, there's a match they want to win. Obviously, because they're already 1-0 in the defense. They want to keep their spotless record and make Mouse Sports go 0-2. Because we're in Group A right now, where SK, Panzer, Western Walls, J4T, Natural 9, now also changed up. There are now known as Absolute Legends. If you haven't checked out that news, of course, the news is up on Join Dota. Oh, wow, so much fun on top. If only Darkseer was closer. Where is Darkseer? He's in the middle lane, trying to deal with fire pushing in. Even these illusions are going to do a lot of damage to Peppy if he's not careful. But luckily for Peppy, he has that Vanguard on him. So life is a little bit easier. Well, this top lane push will keep coming. So it's a double prong attack. Fire through the mid and the rest of the team through the top. And this is the way, the best way J4T can do it. That way, there is no way Darkseer can replicate him. Die of a Sentry. Brewmother goes in. He blinks in on Matrim. He wants to get the first stun. Matrim will come out in just a moment. Surgent back in the main base. He will die nonetheless. And now will it be a kill on RMN? Shackle, I thought I might latch him to camp for just a moment. And a great ES ulti, the Echo as well as Fidget to follow it. The wall goes up. It's a very weird angle here for Peppy. And GG, well played. They realize they've lost too many heroes after this battle. The mid's been pushed down by fire. He will take care of Karani. He's already got himself a Venno ulti on him. But the top will go. And the disconnect comes out from Matrim to start. And J4T. What am I talking about? J4T, take it. Convincing game with the bottom and middle barracks gone. But MTW just having that moment where they just... You kind of got to put it down to the fact that lane just didn't work for them. If Darkseer might have, like, guessed the right lane, but the Weaver pick. Weaver versus Bounty Hunter is never going to come off well for Weaver. Ever. Never, ever, ever. It's going to come off well for Weaver. He just couldn't deal enough damage. Nightstalker got ganked up too much. So he wasn't the tanky kind of guy which they needed to be the aggressive force on the map. And allow them to set up beautifully with Bounty Hunter. Go invis, walk around the map, find someone farming inside the jungle. AA throws the ultimate out. Happened on Darkseer multiple occasions. And on the bottom lane as well. So there's the Radiant victory nonetheless. 47 minutes, 27 seconds. We are going to be back here in just a couple moments' time. Do not go anywhere. We have Team Dignitas going up against Mouse Sports.
I said good day, sir!